for the first time in our history, in the history of our country, more than half of our Congress members are millionaires. And so it really speaks to what is their experience and how are they making decisions. And that information came from an article called Why It Matters That Politicians Have No Experience with Poverty. Because they don't really understand it and they don't really know what to do or how to think about it. One of the ways that we're starting to see and know they think about it is that in media and in social media, there is a resentment toward and demonizing of poor people in the media. You see it, I see it. I don't know how many of you are on Facebook, and I'm friends with people on Facebook that I don't agree with, you know, politically, but they're related to me, so I tolerate it. You know, really look closely at what is the reality of welfare fraud. Does it even exist to the extent that we are led to believe it does? There's a really good website, the National Center for Children on Poverty, and it's through Columbia University, and it has a really good section that talks about what is the reality behind entitlements and all these messages we get about waste and welfare and people on food stamps who don't deserve it, and all of these, again, resentment and demonizing of people in need has very little validity. And so if you go somewhere where the information is accurate and trustworthy, you can be able to educate yourself so that you can have the tools to sort of stand up for that when you see it happening. And then, of course, this whole idea of, you know, well, you're on food stamps, but you can afford an iPhone, seems legit. You know, I saw this on someone else's, on another Facebook feed, and I really had to sort of pull myself back from that. But I guarantee you that many of you have had that same feeling, right? Because money means survival. You need education, but you also need something called social capital. And social capital means spending time with people who aren't like you. Spending time with people who are in middle class, if that's what you aspire to be. And it's funny because I took that notion and I sort of tested it with my son, who's 10. And, you know, I wanted him to be more of a nerdy kid. You know, like I wanted him to be hang out with the nerds and like science and math and all these things. So I purposely would pick play dates with kids who I thought, all right, that kid's kind of dorky. Yeah, fun to hang out with. And so little by little, we've kind of socialized this kid. And he couldn't be nerdier, you know, I mean now. And he couldn't be more interested in things like math and science and doing little projects around the house that really drive me crazy because they make a mess. But the truth is that you put them in situations where they're hanging out with kids who are doing those things. The end result is that, you know, they're going to be like those kids. So that for me was a little project on building social. I argue that money does not change human capacity. Money gets you past survival so that you don't have to stress about all of these things that are coming at you in terms of your financial needs. But money does not build human capacity. Money does not change patterns of thinking. We've seen a lot of people and read a lot of stories in People magazine about people who win the lottery and they come from nothing and then they win like $20 million and what happens to them? And they're in debt after like 5 years. At $20 million, I don't know how you go to debt after you win $20 million, but these people do and it happens. So money does not change patterns of thinking. You know about the Hart and Risley Meaningful Differences study that talked about the number of words that low-income children versus middle-income professional family, middle-income children hear, and how it relates to their school success. Have you heard of this before? It's called, the study is from Hart and Risley. I think it was like 1998 or something. And they've done some updates of it throughout the years. So in 2003, I think there was a newer sort of closer look at that that really tells us that it's not just the number of words. And what they found was that by the age of three, children in low-income families had heard like 13 million words. But by the age of three, children in middle-income or professional homes had heard upwards of like 45 million words. And then correlating that with school success. So that's why we try to encourage parents of young children to talk to your children, right? Especially those families who are coming from low-income homes. Quality of the words. So the other thing they found is that in low-income homes, families who live in poverty, children were hearing two negative instances or interactions, having two negative interactions for every one positive. And it was actually like 4-1 in the middle-income professional homes. And so we're really looking at now, it's not just how many words you speak to your child, but what is the quality of those words. So you can count no, don't, stop as many times as you want, but it's not going to have an impact that as saying something positive to your child would have. Chronic health problems. And the constant that they're finding with all these folks who have chronic health problems like heart disease, diabetes, obesity, substance use, and even mental health problems is that they had these adverse early childhood experiences. And so all of this relates to poverty and the cognitive burden of poverty. It so happens that on Friday on the radio program Where We Live, which is here in Connecticut, there was a good, I'll encourage you to go Google Where We Live and listen to this podcast. There was a really good discussion on how stress and poverty tax the brain. And so back in August of, I think, last summer, there was a really good study that came out that was kind of groundbreaking that told us that, that the impact of poverty on the brain is equivalent to the loss of 13 IQ points. And so when we look at the ability for folks who are living in poverty, who are struggling in poverty, to use their executive functioning, to use their skills, and to have the ability to cognitively understand what they need to do, is decreased by 13 IQ points just for the mere fact that they're having to struggle with daily issues related to their lives of poverty.